Hi there, this is Billy Earl, and this is Lower Shore Politics. I want to welcome a dear friend and a very, very astute observer of politics, both local and national, Mr. Don Rush. Don, how are you today?
Doing well so far.
Good, good. Don, tell me a little bit about your journey through media and how you got here.
Well, as a matter of fact, when I was going to college, I was actually a history major. That's what I got my degree in. And I decided I didn't want to continue on to get a teaching degree, that kind of thing. And actually, I had become friends with some people who were in the school newspaper. And you have to remember, this is about 1970, which meant that there was a lot of things going on, particularly on campus in terms of the anti-war movement. In our particular case, actually, the police actually came onto the campus. So I got a sense of what it was like to look at politics up close and personal and how people were covering it. When I finally got my degree, I looked around for some medium to, say, try to do that sort of thing, and I sort of fell into public radio. I went to a public radio station, Pacific Station, in Los Angeles, and they said, well, we don't have a job, but if you want to learn the trade, you know, you're certainly welcome to volunteer time inside the newsroom, which is basically what I did. So I did that for a few years, got paid on and off, and then I went to an audio news service that was in Los Angeles that covered the state. And then I went back at that same station later on in the 1980s, was news director and reporter there and through up about 1990. And I transferred out to their Washington Bureau in 1990 and stayed there as both a news director and a reporter, most of the time a reporter. To about 2003, covered the Supreme Court, congressional hearings, did a lot of international analysis, covered a few presidential events as well. So I got to see government sort of up close and personal, which was, I think, was a fascinating experience. And then coming here, it's sort of like, well, it's not really retirement, standing retirement, but came here for the job, which was news director. And the shore is really an interesting place to have actually wound up because it's far more diverse than what most people would think. Not only do you obviously have the diversity of, say, tourism and the agricultural industry and the watermen and so on and so forth, but you also have an area that's also changing. It's changing demographically. We have more immigrants coming in, for example, particularly the Hispanic community, Haitian community. We have more people who are retiring here, which has created sort of a grain of the shore, so that's making some more changes. And we obviously have some development going on as well. So it's sort of will be sort of interesting to see how the shore develops in the coming years, because it's going to be, I think in 10 or 20 years, it'll be probably much different than it is right now.
I've heard other people say this too. This is interesting. When you came here and you were looking at the demographics of the Eastern Shore, I'm sure you saw a relatively conservative body of voter. Do you think that still exists, like we think it does?
Well, I think it's yes. I think the Lower Shore and the Shore in general is clearly still far more conservative. What's odd is that when I first got here, which was about 2003, like for instance, the Wicomico County Council had a Democrat as president or chair of the county council, mm-hmm. and there was a majority, Democratic majority. That's been virtually wiped out over the years since then. Republicans as a party, even though some of these can be nonpartisan, as a party has tended to begin to dominate even some of the local government offices, as well as obviously we've also seen changes in legislative representation as well. Norm Conway, who was a delegate from this area, chair of the Appropriations Committee, he was defeated some years back. So that's reduced the Democratic representation from the shore. Than what it had been before. Democrats tend to be, I guess, conservative Democrats for the most part, whatever that may mean.
Yeah.
But Republicans clearly dominate the landscape in terms, I think, of voters and certainly elected officials. So I think, and I think we're still seeing that. I think political change or shift beyond that in terms of party affiliation and philosophy for that matter, I think it's still some ways away.
Okay. Leads us to a big question. There's lots of talk about this wave, about a seismic shift in voting patterns from the more conservative elements to the more liberal elements. Do you see that here?
On the shore, you mean?
Yeah.
I think there is some dissatisfaction, I think, on the shore. I've run into conservatives or people, Republicans, who said that they couldn't, you know, they couldn't vote for Donald Trump. Although they may well wind up voting for Andy Harris. What will be interesting to see is whether or not Andy Harris's connections here on the shore are as strong as they should be, for example. And you get, you know, I talk to individuals and get all these sort of mixed messages. I mean, I'm sure that the folks in Harris's office would say he's got a solid, strong attachment and so on and so forth. And he certainly is well organized. I mean, he's a seasoned politician with a good organization. As far as whether or not you're going to see as much pushback because of Trump as opposed to conservative philosophy, I think is another matter. Because I think when you look at the blue wave, the key to the blue wave is got to be Donald Trump. That doesn't necessarily mean that people are necessarily voting against conservatism, but they're voting against Donald Trump. And I think in that sense, it's Trump that's going to become the key factor, particularly in the midterm elections, just because he reflects on the various Republicans who are now running. Now, the record in Congress has been a little, you know, sporadic. We had, you know, attempts, for instance, to repeal the Affordable Care Act. That didn't go over very well, for example. Right. We do have the tax cuts. We'll see whether or not they have the kind of popularity that, for instance, Republicans wanted to have. The country, though, is, I mean, in some issues, the country is clearly shifting away from what has been, I think, traditional conservative issues like abortion or, well, not necessarily abortion, but certainly gay rights, for example.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's some social shifting going on. I think that's particularly true of the younger voter who doesn't have the attachments as, for instance.
Oh, they're a whole different ballgame.
So when you look at the midterms in particular, I think you've got to separate how much is this a rejection of Donald Trump and those Republicans who say, for instance, have spoken out as well as, for instance, some people would like against him, as opposed to necessarily a rejection of by those voters as a, you know, as in terms of conservative philosophy. So, I mean, I think there's a shift. And, you know, on television, you can see there are a lot of conservative commentators. They show up on MSNBC, which tends to be liberal in nature, I suppose. But a lot of them are very sharply critical of Trump as a president. But that doesn't mean that they've shifted away and left their conservative credentials. Some of the people have described themselves as Republicans without a party, or that they're non-practicing Republicans just for this period. But if things return to normal, I suspect all those people then begin to shift back. So we may be seeing perhaps a one-time or maybe two-time reaction, perhaps as we did, for instance, in the wake of Watergate.
Yeah, I've heard people talk about a burgeoning middle ground. I'm not sure I believe that. I think that there is still a great deal of divisiveness. However, I think there is a growing class of people in the middle who are unaligned. Now, that could take the form all the way from a libertarian to a true conservative that looks at this president and says, he's not really a conservative, he's a Republican, but he's not a conservative, to those large group of Bernie people who don't want to be Republicans, but don't want to be Democrats either. So we now have this strange amalgam in the middle of people that, to some degree, are unaffiliated. It'll be interesting to see where they end up going. So we're headed into 2018 now. And certainly the campaign season's on, and people are talking about all sorts of different things, but Donald J. Trump is certainly dominating what the news is. And much of that discussion has nothing to do with politics.
No, or even particular issues. I mean, if you take, for instance, like the tax cut, since it is a classic example that they passed. This is really traditional Republican stuff. I mean, it's not, mm-hmm. you know, it's not out of the mainstream. You do get things out of the mainstream when it comes, say, for instance, trade as an example. Republicans have been free traders for years. Donald Trump comes along, appeals to a certain particular base, chunk of the Republican Party, which may not have actually been happy with that idea of free trade. And so suddenly you get this division between what the base wants and the general conservative philosophy of the Republican Party. And whether or not that, by the way, will continue to hold will be interesting to see. Just as the Democratic Party had its own divisions within, for instance, the Labor Party and the Labor portion of the party, who was not a big fan of free trade, NAFTA is an example, as opposed to people like Bill Clinton, who came out of the Democratic Leadership Council, who favored free trade and actually got it through, in that case, NAFTA, got it through Congress with basically the help of the Republicans, not necessarily a majority of the Democrats.
That's very true. So here we are looking at 2018, and we know that there is a movement, especially within the what I'd call center to center left, to find candidates more like the 18th congressional in Pennsylvania, somebody closer to the middle, somebody more in the Clinton playbook for election. And I think we're going to see that. I think I am seeing a great deal more mobilization of people, not necessarily fully engaged in working for a candidate, but much more interested than they've ever been before, paying a lot more attention and trying to figure out in this puzzle, where do they fit and where do they think they can help?
Well, I think you're getting a, you know, to return to Trump for a moment, the reaction to Trump has clearly generated a lot of activity and a lot of in terms of just the regular folks. Many of them showed up at some of the marches, who may not have necessarily been part of party politics, but they become activated, and because they're reacting to things, for instance, Trump, then you get them sliding into the Democratic column, at least for this time, maybe next time, right? So people talk a little bit about intensity being much more on the Democratic side this time as opposed to the Republican side. And I think a large part of that's true in the sense, not so much of the particular issues as it is just the person who was in the White House. I suppose the counter or the analogy would be in 2010 when you had Barack Obama as a president, Democrat, and there was the Tea Party, which was formed that year, and much of that was a reaction against the president, the Democratic president. Obviously, some of the key issues were things like health care, that kind of thing, but in large part, there was a reaction to the Democratic president. We may be seeing something that going on now, but it's on the Republican side. And then the question for Republicans is, well, how much intensity is there going to be for these congressional candidates particularly, or the Senate candidates? Is there enough, do they have enough intensity to counter the kind of activism that we've seen? I suspect the answer is no, but then there are, you know, gerrymandering advantages that Republicans have, mm-hmm. just as Democrats had during the 1980s, for example. So you've got some of the technicals running against Democrats as far as taking over the House or maybe even taking the Senate. On the other hand, it's not impossible. So I mean, we'll kind of see whether or not those technicals can be overcome. And right now, I mean, a couple of things. One, I saw report, I think it's the Cook Report, which follows congressional and Senate mm-hmm. candidates. And they're now looking at 50 potential competitive seats in the Republican, that's now controlled by Republicans, only 5 for Democrats. So Charlie Cook, who's really good at this stuff.
He's a smart boy.
Yeah, they're looking at a possibility. And of course, just recently we had Frank Luntz, who's a Republican pollster, say that he's picking up on a one-on-one kind of anecdotal basis. Same kind of thing where the Republicans could really be in trouble. How big will it be, for instance, 1994? Nobody knows.
Yeah. Nate Silver at 538 is coming up with the same kind of numbers. So here he is, they're looking at it, and they're thinking, okay, we've got to do this. But I think they're making another tacit assumption. And I know with my family, this is true, because I come from a historically conservative Republican family. And that is not voting. And first time ever. Staying home, not being part of the party mechanism, not giving money to the party, and just kind of waiting for this dust to settle. I know there's a lot of people here that I've talked to that seem to be in the same boat. They don't want to be part of that, but they're not willing to become a liberal Democrat or even, you know, a centrist Democrat because of the stigma.
Well, I mean, right. I mean, and if you voted Republican all of your life, it's very difficult to go ahead and shift. Just if you're a traditional Democrat, you will find it difficult. You will get major shifts every once in a while. For instance, the Reagan Democrats are a classic example. There's a major shift that took place, not only in terms of the population, only in terms of the voting patterns, but also party affiliation as well. Mm-hmm. So you do get these shifts and changes. If I were Republican, the thing I would be looking at would be the younger generation that's coming up, whether it's the millennials or the generation after that. Where are they going? We understand, at least for the moment, they're shifting to the Democratic Party. Now, thing is that as the older they get, that can change, right? Because they're highly flexible.
Most likely will.
That's right. Highly flexible in their younger years. Later on, they may decide that they're a bit more conservative, whatever that might mean at the time, and they may then become part of the Republican Party. Although they may change the Republican Party as well. I mean, because the Republican Party right now has come out of this very traditional, from the 1970s, a certain backlash to the 1960s, a very traditional, what was at least considered to be traditional American values and issues that sort of grew up out of the period. All that's obviously begun to change, particularly with new generation. So the question becomes, in addition to demographics, which is another problem for them nationally, is whether or not the Republican Party will be able to keep up with that shift. A classic example is, for instance, marriage equality, gay rights. The nation shifted dramatically within a matter of 10 years.
From
2004, where it was a wedge issue for Republicans, to now it's, you have a lot of Republicans who basically support it, say it's okay. You're getting those kinds of shifts. And so, and that 20 or 30 years ago, marriage equality would not have even been on the table. That's opposition to that would have been traditional Republican values. So you see some of this stuff beginning to shift and change.
It does. It also kind of draws my interest as an issue like that, because there was a great deal of religious impact on gay rights, that it was an abomination in the Bible, and that abortion was prohibited by the Bible, although if you read it carefully in the book of Genesis, it says that life starts at the first breath. So I'm not sure that in the same way that people who follow Donald Trump, who are evangelicals, that they have a straight line of moral superiority. I think there's been a history of some deviation on this from what you really would classify as true biblical thinking and true biblical thought. Now, here we are going into 2018, and I think you'll see a great deal of wrapping yourself in the flag and in the Bible as it comes up, because those are go-to kind of mechanisms. But I don't know if that's going to work all that well with young people.
Well, and I don't know how strong it's going to be. I mean, I do think that's true. Take, for instance, the issue of abortion. The stats on that, the numbers in terms of polling, has been pretty steady, really, over the decades.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, after Roe versus Wade, there was many expectations that there would be dramatic changes in public opinion, and there were to some extent. But we haven't seen that. So if you put that one aside for a moment, then you have something like gay rights, for example, where there does seem to be a shift, and we'll see how the evangelical community continues to react to that. You certainly have leadership which says, which is concerned about, for instance, religious liberty as an overall concept, and wanting to be comfortable in that, and how they intersect, really, with the secular world in terms of business, because that's what's happening. If you have an institution, a religious institution, which say has a business, well, then suddenly you're moving out of the church and into the public square. Well, how do you square those? And that's something that
you're in commerce.
The Supreme Court has been struggling with that. I mean, actually, for many years. So you've got these various issues, but I don't see the evangelical movement as strong as it once was. I mean, it was fairly well organized coming out of the late 1970s into mm-hmm. the Christian Coalition, for example, Pat Robertson, amongst others, Ralph Reed. They all tried to organize this and utilize the churches almost as if, and they said this, as if they were labor union halls, organizing. So they tried to do that as well. I'm not sure that's it's going to be as effective, but it's still a very serious voting block, and one certainly Republicans must recognize as part of their base. And in that sense, you know, Donald Trump, whatever his personal issues are, he's doing what they want to do. He's appointing conservative judges. He talks about, you know, backing, you know, religious freedom and so on. And
that's
so
exactly what they say when asked.
Yeah. So that he is doing that bidding, as it were, those imposing those ideas, despite whatever issues there are on a personal level.
Mm-hmm. Well, strangely enough, I think after the Obama administration, I think evangelicals had a hero in George Bush. Now, you then get to Barack Obama, who I think probably displayed as much of what I would consider to be orthodox Christian values during his presidency, but it wasn't perceived that way at all. Now we have a president who does things that the evangelical right would approve of, and so now they're all on board. But how long can that last?
You mean for Trump?
Yeah.
I think it could last as long as he's there. I mean, something really bad has to happen, and I know that, we've all been waiting for that bad thing to happen because there are all these escalating issues that he's got. As long as he's...
What if it were shown that he did conspire with the Soviet Union to throw the election?
The Russians? I'm not sure. I mean, it doesn't seem...
Isn't that odd, though? And
the thing is, when you say shown, well, in what fashion? To show in terms of convincing somebody, that's a different manner of, you know, people... There are a lot of folks, particularly not just conservatives, but a lot of people who are looking at the Russian stuff, and they hear all this stuff all the time. And, you know, it's not like you and I where we follow each, you know, click.
Right.
And it's all kind of a blur to them. I said, well, I don't know, right, whether or not what people are saying about the Bush, the Trump campaign and the Russians are really true, or what's it like. And then you also have the other issue, which, of course, is that questions have been now raised about, for instance, the justice system, right? This whole stuff that's been coming out and been pushed by political leaders. I mean, I take the position that I think the Justice Department is probably doing a fairly decent job, and I, you know, but nonetheless, but in politics, it doesn't matter. It's, you raise doubts. So if you raise doubts about the investigation, then how do you show that something's happened, right, to somebody who has questions about it? So I think that, I'm not sure that's going to be that relevant, but we'll see. I mean, you know, there's also the issue about whether or not this is the Russian thing is enough to push, say, for instance, we've talked about it earlier before the show about the concept of impeachment, for example, right? I don't know whether that's enough for people to say, oh yes, we should do this. I mean, and because we have to remember that impeachment is a political process. It's not a judicial one. And even with Richard Nixon, the public had finally turned against him in a much different era without social media. And I can remember going into work and hearing on my little transistor radio that the three Republicans had gone up to the White House to tell Nixon it was all over, he had to resign.
Right,
smoking tape, right? And by that time, the whole thing had been going on for so long that there was a political decision made within the public as well as the Republican leadership, who was in the minority at the time in Congress. No, he has to resign. I'm not sure you're going to see that in the future with this particular president, and it's going to have to be really, really clear, crystal clear. And in politics, it can get pretty blurry.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sure that there will be enough. And I don't. Democrats have shied away from the I word, which, you know, is logical because they want to see what the investigation, particularly Mueller, has to say in the end. And it looks as if he certainly will issue some kind of report, which will be interesting.
Right.
And whether or not that has any impact or not. I mean, I don't know.
Well, it'll certainly be a contest to see how much of the content of this investigation actually makes it to the rank and file. Because I guarantee you, a lot of people are not going to read it because they're not going to want to.
Well, and it's also very complicated.
Extremely.
You think about, for instance, the Clinton impeachment. That was really, I mean, looking back, that was really crystal clear about, did he say things that were not true or implying not true during a deposition? And what was his relationship with Monica Lewinsky? And all that stuff was very, very crystal clear. So the Republicans then drew these sort of large issues, like obstruction of justice, for example, and said, no, this is what we think the president did. And even then, what was interesting is that even when it was crystal clear, the majority of Clinton's popularity continued to rise. It did not fall. And people separated out a personal life as opposed to high crimes and misdemeanors. And I will tell you, by the way, being in Washington at the time, Republicans, when they started out on this track, did not think that it would go to impeachment. I mean, they did not think that this was the road ahead. It just had its moment. It had a moment all of its own, with people just taking the next step and the next step and the next step. And suddenly, here they're having impeachment hearings. Well, if you're committed, you got to go all the way. And you can make a decision as whether or not he should have been impeached, not impeached, and so on and so forth. But there was the issues there were much clearer. The Russian thing is much more complicated. And I mean, I saw Geraldo Rivera, I think, on Bill Maher the other night, and basically said, show me the collusion, right? And you know, you can say, and Maher's response was, well, we haven't had the end of the investigation yet, despite Geraldo's impatience with it. Nor did Geraldo, for instance, note that there were all these meetings and so on and so forth, contacts between the Russians and various people within the campaign. Whether that stretched up to Donald Trump is another matter. Whether there's an impact, for instance, on Trump's efforts to build in Russia, whether it had any influence on what his thinking was, or whether it was any direct, all that's kind of mushy, and we won't know what the outcome is until Mueller does issue, I guess, a report. And even then, it may be so complex that it's not the kind of clear-cut issue as, say, for instance, the Watergate break-in or the Monica Lewinsky affair.
Well, the degree to which Robert Mueller invokes Section 208 of the U.S. Code, I think, will be pivotal in this, because this is the bribery statute. And the guidelines on it are quid pro quo. We know that there was an attempt on the Russian party, by the Russian oligarch and their trolls, to affect the election. We also know that at least in one instance there was an attempt by the Trump administration, before they ever got into office, to supply the pro, and that was changing the platform by which the Republican Party was viewing the Soviet regime. So the degree to which people look at that and say, okay, that meets a technical definition of bribery based on case law and based on the statute in the United States Code. Whether they will then look at that and say, okay, that's enough for me to call my congressman, because again, people won't have a vote in this. This will all be done in the House of Representatives.
Right, right.
So as they're sitting there making their decision, they're going to have to weigh, okay, we've lost the House. We're now going to lose the Senate. Do we really want to dismantle our party, or are we just going to ignore it?
Well, political parties, I mean, they can actually respond in ways that leads to their destruction.
Nobody wants,
the only party to do that actually in the United States history is the Whig Party, and they fell apart over a very serious issue, which of course was slavery. But the thing of it another way, though, and that is that, and we're talking about the Russians, because one of the things when I started first hearing about this, I said, well, you know, maybe the Russians are like just poking around, right? I mean, there's almost an odd thing. Well, then, but you get more and more. I mean, you got the Trump Tower and stuff meeting, and Manafort, for example, he denies that he was behind the platform change. But imagine that, well, Manafort was so deep into the Ukrainian, the Russian stuff that Trump didn't have to really know what was going on. I mean, it wasn't something that Trump would said, oh, yeah, go ahead and do this, right? I mean, it's so you got all these people doing all these things, but doesn't necessarily mean that the guy at the top knew all the details.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think that's part of the problem. And so does it really go up to him? We won't know. For example, in the Iran-Contra scandal that took place.
Right.
It stopped at, I think it was Poindexter, who was, I think, his chief of staff, or one of, right, who They were asked, did you tell the president about this deal? And he said no. And as soon as that was, as soon as he uttered those words, it was done. Reagan was out in the clear. It was the people below him. So now you can say he should be responsible for the people below him and all that, but nonetheless, removing a president is a very serious thing. And I think that trying to make that leap.
I don't recall. Did they ask Caspar Weinberger that?
Well,
from his jail cell?
Well, no, I don't think he went to jail. He didn't go to jail. But so the same thing then that applies to Trump is, okay, all these people are doing these things, including his sons, by the way, right?
Yeah.
At least these meetings, anyways, by the way. But did it really reach to the old man? I mean, obviously he had, obviously Russian interests and so on and so forth.
Right.
And then you then take a look at, well, what has been the record of the Trump administration since then? Well, the president certainly has had only nice good things to say about Putin, except perhaps this latest thing with the Syrian gassing. But his administration, they sent the weapons to Ukraine, despite anything in a Republican platform. There were these things that the administration has been doing, or the institutions have been doing, that the president has gone along with. You know, he can say that he was reluctant about it, but nonetheless, it has moved forward. So, I don't know whether, I mean, it's also very clear that they, and I was been reading this book about the Russians back in 2013, they basically announced that they saw warfare as a cyber warfare, talked about social media.
Full warning.
So now we didn't know exactly what they were going to do, but nonetheless, that's what they were going to do. And in the end, one of the questions becomes, if I'm Vladimir Putin, one of the things, if I'm thinking ahead, is whether or not what's happened, what has transpired in terms of involvement, getting Trump, of perception of certainly getting Trump into the White House, whether or not it's going to backfire terribly. Because imagine Donald Trump leaving and, say, a Democrat getting in there, I can imagine very much higher line to the Russians. Even a Republican getting in. The Republicans, they passed those sanctions. They might wind up being really tougher on the
Russians. Could very well be.
So that it may actually blow back on Trump and on Putin in a way that he did not anticipate.
Couldn't agree more. Don, thank you so much for coming in today. You have been a marvelous guest. All I had to do was say, hi, Don, how are you? Anyway, this is Billy Earl. This is Lower Shore Politics. Thank you. And in the words of Louis Goldstein, God bless y'all real good.